This is a presentation for the United States Soybean Export Council by Skip Kemp, a visual guide to understanding and using the IPRS in-pond raceway system. Mixing, also add a few fish. The United States Soybean Export Council is introducing the in-pond raceway system around the world to improve fish farming using high-quality U.S. soy-based feeds. This is a worthwhile effort because fish convert soybean protein into muscle mass better than every other farm animal. And so by adopting the IPRS method, both fish farmers and U.S. soybean farmers benefit. But also the planet benefits, as we'll discuss later. So it's a win-win situation all around the world. Hi, and good morning. My name is Skip Kemp, and I'm pleased to be your guide through this program on the in-pond raceway system, or IPRS. I've been involved with aquaculture since I stocked catfish on our family farm in 1969. I was 14 years old. And when the feeding frenzy started, man, it was me that was hooked on aquaculture. And I've been hooked on it ever since. I've had a long career educating and training future aqua farmers, and I look forward to sharing some of the lessons that I've learned over those years. I actually built a raceway system 50 years ago. It was quite different from the designs of today. More on that later. But the modern IPRS has evolved with research and on-farm improvements to become a very profitable system that can double or triple the yields in your existing ponds. It's not a new technology in itself, but it's a well-designed combination of existing aquaculture principles. Main principle, flowing water. The IPRS essentially turns the pond into a stream. The benefits are a dynamic and well-mixed water column with lots of dissolved oxygen to do the biological work of the pond, much better than a static pond. Another is the collection and removal of solid waste. That can't be done in an open pond, but it can be done in the IPRS because of the flowing water and the third principle, confinement, which also has many other benefits. Compared with the old methods, the IPRS can maintain healthier fish, and if you want to conserve water or if you need to conserve water, reduce pollution and make more effective use of your inputs, such as feed, labor, and energy, then the IPRS is the way to go. And on top of that, the fish farming system that we're talking about, it makes fish farming fun again. Stay tuned and you'll see why. Do these sound like bold claims? Well, keep watching and you'll learn about the principles and the science behind them that make the system work so well. We hope this video is an enlightening and informative learning experience that accompanies the manual. And we also hope many more farmers will adopt these techniques and improve their ponds' performance and profits. Bottom line is that the IPRS system really works, but only if you learn the principles well and apply them to your farm strictly. Don't deviate or wander, and you'll have success with the IPRS. Are you ready to learn about this amazing system? Let's dive in and start the program. We need aquaculture and the IPRS now more than ever. There are some very timely reasons that aquaculture is the right thing to do for the people and for the planet. There are challenges and opportunities ahead, and the IPRS is the best way forward to meet them. Let's take a look. Global population is expected to grow from 8 billion this year in 2020 to 9 billion in 10 years, 10 billion by 2050, and 11 billion in 2100. By then, Africa will be as populous as Asia, and that's a lot of people to feed. The main challenges for this increasing population? Food supplies are strained. We need to produce more food and do so economically. Land and water resources are stretched. Urban sprawl and water shortages are real concerns. The environment is stressed. Even with a lot of progress in conservation, pollution is still a problem. And farming production inputs are soaring, with the largest cost being feed, energy, and labor. Fortunately, population increases are being accompanied by reduced poverty levels. So this is good news globally, as more people are moving from vulnerable to the middle class and able to buy more expensive meals, such as muscle protein foods. With that information, a study of ocean management projected that by 2050, there will be an 80% increase in demand for animal protein. The study goal was to see how much more we could get from the oceans if we managed them perfectly, but the results were discouraging, so they looked at aquaculture, compared it with other animal farming, and found that if we did it right, aquaculture could provide the entire 80% increase, more economically and with minimal impact on the environment. Seafood harvests from the oceans have reached their maximum sustainable yields for the last 25 years and can't meet the growing demand for seafood. But aquaculture can fill the gap and it can help protect the oceans and reduce the problem of overfishing. Global aquaculture production surpassed capture fisheries in 2012 and now supplies more seafood to the world. Feed conversion ratio, or FCR, which is the amount of feed it takes to produce a gain in weight, varies with farm animals. Cattle take about 7 kilograms of feed for 1 kilogram of weight gain. Hogs, about 3 kilograms. Poultry, around 2. And fish, very efficient. Depending upon species and growing conditions, just a little more than 1 kilogram of feed to grow 1 kilogram of fish. What this means is that for a given amount of feed, you can put more fish on the plate than any other animal. Protein, energy, and feed conversion ratios are called resource efficiencies. These are important factors when comparing the production of meat animals. Take a look at some of these factors to see how fish stand out in superior performance. The post-harvest factor of edible yield per kilogram of feed is extremely favorable toward fish. Depending upon the species, it's 3 to 4 times higher than other animals. And not only that, but fish is delicious and good for you too. It also means more fish on the plate for the same amount of feed. Compare the greenhouse gas of animal production. You have lamb and beef very high at one end of the scale, but you have fish, eggs, and chicken very low at the other end of the scale. How much land does it take to farm these animals? Fish, chicken, and hogs can be grown in high densities, but lamb and beef require large amounts of land. Water scarcity is occurring worldwide and is a real concern for the future. As you can see from this slide, many areas are already in danger, and some will be critical over the next 20 years, 2030 to 2040. IPRS conserves water in many ways. It does not require draining ponds to harvest, and with solid waste removal and dissolved oxygen management, it requires no water exchange. The same water can be reused year after year. Stretching land resources leads to intensified agriculture and is often accompanied by pollution, diseases, and the use of chemicals. However, the IPRS provides a healthy growing environment with less stress and fewer disease problems. When implemented according to the principles and compared with traditional methods, it maintains better water quality in the pond, healthier fish, and eliminates environmental pollution. As an overview to put the IPRS in perspective with other aquaculture methods, I like to use this slide that shows the increase in production potential with increasing levels of management. To increase production to the next level, you have to overcome the limitations of the previous one and, of course, stock more fingerlings. While actual numbers vary among species and farms, there is the potential to double production as you go more intensive from one level to the next. Extensive production is simply harvesting what grows on the natural food in the pond. Let's say we can produce around 1x amount of fish on the available natural food. When that becomes limiting, you can fertilize the pond to produce more natural food and increase the size of the food chain. Stock more fingerlings and grow 10 times more fish. When natural food alone becomes limiting, stock more fingerlings and add supplemental feeds to double the production again. At this level, you may have some low DO at night. To move to level 4, you need to use complete feeds that contain all the essential nutrients for growth because there won't be enough natural food to supply any meaningful amount of nutrition. You will also need to have emergency aeration available because of the DO decline almost every night, and you'll start to have other water quality problems. Exchanging water in the pond, along with continuous aeration, can maintain water quality to increase production. But at this level, you are still limited by water quality and the available water supply and the cost of aeration and pumping. You can ultimately double production again with the IPRS, which efficiently utilizes feed and energy to maintain better water quality and healthier fish. Stick with me to learn how the IPRS overcomes limitations to modernize fish farming. A flowing stream is an ideal environment. It has a constant supply of fresh water, constant aeration, constant nutritious feeding, and constant removal of waste. Imagine if we could replicate that system in a pond. You guessed it. The IPRS mimics those conditions for an ideal pond environment. There are three guiding principles for the success of the in-pond raceway system. Flowing water, mixing, and dissolved oxygen management. Remember, this is really three principles in one. We can create a river within the pond that continually mixes the water column and increases the oxygen at the bottom. Collection and removal of solid waste from the pond in the quiescent zone reduces BOD and allows the carrying capacity of the water to be increased. Confinement, which has many benefits to the farmer, including efficient feeding, is a key principle, and raceways make it happen. Because it's difficult to see the riverine water flow in the pond, I made this animation to show the number one principle of IPRS, flowing water. This slide also shows the primary components of the concept. So let's put this in motion. The flow is created through efficient aeration devices called whitewater units. These are an airlift type of aerator, and they're located in the head of the raceways. More details on those later. The flow is routed through the channel-shaped raceways, then through a quiescent zone and out into the open pond. Water must flow around the entire pond due to the placement of a baffle fence, which prevents short-circuiting or backflow to the beginning of the raceway without proper treatment. The open pond is where biological oxidation takes place to assimilate nutrients and recondition the water before re-entering the raceway cells. Now, this is where the real work occurs that increases the carrying capacity of the pond. For every raceway whitewater unit, there must be another whitewater unit placed in the open pond area, preferably at least one in each corner. That helps to maintain the riverine flow pattern and to keep the pond mixed vertically. Mixing, also called destratification, is a key feature because water near the bottom with the least amount of oxygen is moved up to the surface and aerated by the whitewater units. This fact just adds to their efficiency. Paddle wheel aerators splash the surface waters. Those already have the most dissolved oxygen in the pond, and sometimes, during periods of supersaturation, paddle wheels can actually remove oxygen from the water, just like shaking a carbonated drink. Conversely, whitewater units gently mix the water column top to bottom. thereby increasing the total amount of oxygen by weight in the pond system. The target fed species are held in the raceways, and unfed fish, called service species, are grown in the open pond without pelleted feed. The service species are filter feeders, or detrital feeders, and they improve water quality by their feeding habits, and also produce an extra crop of fish, essentially for free. The quiescent zone area is located in the tail end of the raceway. The flow of water bumps the waste along the bottom until it enters the quiescent zone, where it settles and collects until it's removed with pumps or dredges. The number one principle. If you take away only one thing from this presentation, I hope it will be the importance of this dynamic flowing system that mixes the water column and distributes dissolved oxygen to the bottom of the pond. With that said, let's go more in depth on this principle. Dissolved oxygen is the most important element in aquaculture systems. It drives the biological system of a pond like it drives a fire. I made this demonstration to show the effect that oxygen has on a combustion reaction, which is the same as the biological reaction in a pond that drives respiration, decomposition, and nitrification. So the more oxygen, the faster that these biological processes can go. Gains and losses of dissolved oxygen are also called sources and sinks. The main source of dissolved oxygen is phytoplankton, which photosynthesizes during the day from sunlight to produce oxygen. Diffusion is also a source, and mechanical aeration is a source, but we'll get into that a little later. The sinks, respiration is the biggest use of oxygen in a system. Decomposition and nitrification also use oxygen. But look at the amount of oxygen that's used just by the plankton, 60%. 20% by the fish, and 20% by the benthic respiration. In this slide, we're going to demonstrate the power of phytoplankton. Did you know that during the photosynthetic peak hours, 11 o'clock to 3 o'clock, phytoplankton can increase the surface dissolved oxygen at a rate of 2 milligrams per liter per hour? So let's have some fun with aquamath and show this mathematically. We want to calculate the weight of dissolved oxygen per hour in the top 0.5 meter of a 1 hectare pond. Okay, in order to do that, we need to know the volume of the pond, which is depth times area. We'll use a conversion ratio, and then we'll use the rate of 2 milligrams per liter per hour and another conversion, and we'll end up with the weight. So it is the layer that we're talking about is 0.5 meters deep, pond area, 10,000 square meters per hectare, conversion to liters, rate of 2 milligrams per liter per hour, and a conversion back to kilograms. So the answer, 10 kilograms of dissolved oxygen per hour are added to the pond just in the top half a meter by the photosynthetic activity of the plankton. And that's just in those 4 hours. Let's calculate the size of a paddle wheel to produce an equivalent weight of dissolved oxygen, 10 kilograms. So if the paddle wheel SOTR rating is 1 kilogram of oxygen per horsepower per hour. Now the SOTR, standard oxygen transfer rate, that's how much oxygen is added by the device in a laboratory setting with pure water. Okay, so we know that in ponds, actually, we don't have pure water, and we're not in a laboratory condition. But anyway, for the exercise, let's continue. So the paddle wheel horsepower is going to be the weight of the algae, the weight of oxygen produced by the algae, and divided by the weight of the oxygen produced by the aerator, and that'll give us the horsepower. So we got 10 kilograms of oxygen. Now, if we divide by a fraction, it's the same as multiplying by the inverse. So we're going to multiply this. 1 kilogram of DO per horsepower hour is the same as multiplying by the inverse. Okay, enough of that. So the horsepower requirement, 10 horsepower. That's a big paddle wheel. And that's just one pond, and that's just the top half a meter. So for extra credit, what is the huge unknown in this scenario? The actual aeration efficiency is unknown, AAE. So the paddle wheel rating was standard, but we don't know how it's going to act. We do know that in a pond, it's going to be less than it would be in the laboratory, much less. And that depends upon the saturation of the water and other factors. So for the win on this question, what is a much better solution? Let's hear a drum roll. Mix the surface water downward and the bottom water upward. That's what the white water unit does, and that's why it works so effectively. The dissolved oxygen of a pond fluctuates daily. This is a 24-hour period of time from morning through the noon, midnight, back to the next morning. As you can see, oxygen levels start low in the morning after night. They rise during the day when the sun is shining and photosynthesis occurs, and then they start dropping at night again. And that's almost a linear drop. We'll talk about that in a second. But these are three different levels of plankton bloom: a light bloom, moderate bloom, and a heavy plankton bloom. So saturation, as we've talked about, varies with temperature, but let's just put it at 6 mg/L. Now we can predict what the dissolved oxygen level will be by morning. But first of all, let's take a look at the saturation levels. Anything below the saturation is called hypoxia, and anything above is supersaturated. So let's take a look. When we draw a straight line down the slope of the light plankton bloom, we can see that we're in safe territory. We're above 6. We're above saturation. It's going to be good. The same thing occurs with a moderate plankton bloom, although the slope is a little bit steeper. But the heavy plankton bloom is going to run out of oxygen before morning, and we're going to have to start aeration. This is what we want to try to avoid, is these heavy plankton blooms. By using the white water mixing, we can thin out those blooms, mix the dissolved oxygen better in the pond, and we won't have these extreme highs and lows. A heavy phytoplankton bloom can lead to this supersaturation that we've talked about. And we use a secchi disc to determine the visibility of the bloom. With low visibilities or shallow visibilities, this is going to lead to a really heavy phytoplankton bloom that can cause some supersaturation. This is analogous to the popping or shaking a can of soda, carbonated soda, which is supersaturated with carbon dioxide, which that'll release this carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. So the same thing can happen in a pond that's supersaturated at the surface when we turn on a paddle wheel aerator. Splashing the water is going to release that supersaturated oxygen into the atmosphere. A better way to do that is with a gentler flowing motion that's caused by the white water unit that's mixing the bottom and the top waters without splashing. Physical and chemical stratification of pond water from surface to bottom. There's a decline in light intensity, photosynthesis, oxygen levels, and water temperature. Without oxygen, bottom water and the bottom soil become anaerobic and build up toxic substances such as ammonia, nitrite, methane, and hydrogen sulfide. Fish and shrimp avoid these anaerobic areas of the ponds. On the right side is a destratified pond using the IPRS concept of flowing aerated water using the white water airlift units. The pond holds a greater weight of oxygen that can speed the important biological oxidation of water treatment. Let's have some more fun with aquamath. In this exercise, we're going to demonstrate the concept of mixing mathematically, and we're going to compare the dissolved oxygen dynamics of a stratified pond and a well-mixed pond. For this purpose, let's look at a hypothetical 1-hectare pond 2 meters deep. It's stratified with 3 water layers. The top layer is supersaturated with 12 mg/L. It's 0.5 meter thick, or 0.5 meter deep. The middle layer is a subsaturation. It's 4 milligrams per liter, and it's a 1 meter layer of water. The bottom layer is hypoxic. It is 2 milligrams per liter, and that's a 0.5 meter layer of water. Okay, for the first part of this exercise, we're going to find out what is the total weight of dissolved oxygen in a stratified pond. Calculate the total weight of oxygen in a 1 hectare pond 2 meters deep if the top 1/2 meter layer of water has a DO of 12, the next 1 meter layer has a DO of 4, and the bottom 1/2 meter has a DO of 2. I'm going to calculate for each layer and the total. So the top layer has the pond volume times the DO level and 2 conversion factors to find the weight. So the volume is 10,000 square meters times 1/2 meter. That'll give you cubic meters. Dissolved oxygen was 12, and a conversion to kilograms and a conversion to liters gives us a dissolved oxygen of 60 kilograms. So follow the math here, and we get the middle layer is 40 kilograms. The bottom layer is 10 kilograms of oxygen. So the total weight of dissolved oxygen in the pond is 110 kilograms dissolved oxygen. Now that we have determined the total amount of oxygen in a stratified pond, we're going to calculate a theoretical dissolved oxygen level if we evenly mix that oxygen throughout the entire pond. So we're going to turn that weight from kilograms into milligrams, and we end up with 1.1 times 10 to the 8th milligrams. We're going to convert the pond volume in liter to liters from cubic meters, and that would be 2 times 10 to the 7th liters. So if we do the math, to calculate the mixed dissolved oxygen, we divide the milligrams of oxygen by the liters of water in the pond to get milligrams per liter. So we have 5.5 milligrams per liter of dissolved oxygen. Very good example of the value of mixing a stratified pond, because that dissolved oxygen level is entirely sufficient. There are two main purposes for aeration. One is to increase the dissolved oxygen, of course, when it's low. And another is to mix water vertically and horizontally. Now, this is to bring the lower dissolved oxygen water in so it can be more efficiently aerated, and to push away the water that is already aerated so it can get to the organisms that need it. There are other benefits for aeration, such as stripping out gases, such as carbon dioxide, nitrite, hydrogen sulfide, ammonia, and methane. It stabilizes pH because of the CO2 reduction. The white water unit is an airlift type of an aerator and pump. It's not really a pump as much as it is a water mover. But the airlift design, it supports a large diffuser grid and is powered by a small horsepower regenerative blower. The blower efficiently pushes a high volume of low pressure air to a submerged grid of diffuser tubing called AeroTube. This brand has been proven to be very effective for this purpose. The white water unit floats on the water surface and maintains a set depth for the diffuser grid. They're made to be a standard width so they can be installed on any raceway, as well as installed for free floating in the open pond. Some of the factors that affect the airlift operation. We need to maximize the amount of air and the number of bubbles going to this unit. We can do that by pushing more air from a stronger blower, or we can raise the diffuser grid up in the water column, reducing the pressure and the back pressure on the blower. We can also use the type of diffuser tubing called the AeroTube. This is very porous and has been found to be very efficient. So another factor affecting the airlift operation is that rising bubbles create an upward flow of water. Each bubble pushes water ahead of it and pulls water behind it from drag. So millions of these bubbles rising will create a huge, gigantic flow of water upward. Then this flow is directed across and down into the raceway. The size of bubbles affects the rate and rise of diffusion. Basically, the smallest bubbles rise very slowly. So the smaller the bubble, you may get better oxygen diffusion because of the length of time that'll be in contact and the surface volume ratio, but they just will not rise fast enough to create a good flow. So there's a trade-off here. It should be parallel to the water surface because there's, with this low pressure, there's even small differences can reduce the performance by pushing most of the air out of the side that's shallower in depth. The depth of the air introduction affects the delivery, meaning that the deeper depths restricts the airflow with more back pressure, requires more horsepower to push air down, and it will have longer time in contact and can increase the flow rate. It comes at the expense of the greater energy requirement to do so. Aeration is also a very big part of principle number one of flowing water, mixing, and dissolved oxygen management, because this is how we can maintain a steady level of oxygen in the pond. Now this is a paddle wheel aerator, everybody's familiar with that. Pushes water up into the air. Water is heavy, so it takes a lot of energy, a high horsepower, but also take a look at how far away some of the fish may be from this source of aeration. Now the white water unit that's used is the heart of the system for this IPRS, and it uses air, diffused air, so air is lightweight, so when we're pushing air down, it's not as heavy as water and it takes less energy to operate it. So we're going to take a look here. Now this is a white water unit operating. And this is just a small horsepower air blower pushing air down to the diffuser grid, and that's rising up through a hood and being forced into the raceway. And you can see the fish there swimming right there where the aeration is provided. It's a good example of the efficiency of this system. This shows a comparison between the efficiency of dissolved oxygen delivery to fish from two types of aerators and two fish culture systems, open ponds and raceways. With the same amount of fish and the same DO demand, the raceway uses far less horsepower to deliver the required oxygen. Fish in raceways do not have to compete for dissolved oxygen, unlike fish in open ponds, where they must compete with phytoplankton and benthic bacteria for limited oxygen supplies. Most of the energy expended by paddle wheels does not benefit the fish directly and is an inefficient form of aeration. Whitewater units are the next best thing to precision aeration, which is applied directly to the fish. This is a side view of a whitewater unit showing the various parts of the aerator. High volume, low pressure air is forced to a diffuser grid by efficient low horsepower blowers. The diffuser grid is constructed with many parallel lengths of porous tubing called aerotube, which has very many holes per square centimeter, and it has very low back pressure, so it can pass a huge volume of air to make small bubbles. Aerotube is the standard tubing used and has been proven superior to other brands. The bubbles are semi-contained in a box-shaped unit so that all bubbles pass upward through the box. As the bubbles rise, they push and pull water along with them, creating an upward flow of water. At the top of the box is an angled lid called a hood that directs the bubbles and upward flowing water toward and into the raceway. The top of the hood is always above the surface of the pond water, otherwise the flow may be directed backwards. Note that the velocity of water flow is greater at the surface and slower with depth. This exists near the whitewater unit, and as the water travels down the extent of the raceway, the flow velocity is more uniform from top to bottom. except the bottom velocity is always a little slower due to friction with the raceway floor. It's important to maintain the proper velocity so that solid waste particles can be swept down the length of the raceway to be collected in the quiescent zone. This is another animation that I made up to show how the whitewater unit works. In motion, it shows the airlift concepts that create an upward flow of water by the rising of millions of bubbles which emanate from this diffuser grid. Other parts are the deflector hood, the knee wall, and a confinement gate which keeps the fish in, of course, and the raceway wall. Let's put this in motion. Now, a few bubbles, it's not going to make a lot of difference. It's not going to help much. So what we want to do is produce as many bubbles as we possibly can with the amount of energy that we can expend. And this is why this system with the low horsepower blowers, low pressure, high volume air is works so well with this diffuser grid. I'm going to add and put all the bubbles that we can get in there. So that we have an upward flow of bubbles that pushes water ahead of each bubble and pulls water behind it with the friction. So as you can imagine, millions and millions of these bubbles flowing upward is going to produce a pretty strong flow of water. Now there's a trade-off between the small size of bubbles, which the smaller the bubble and the surface to area volume ratio, we'll have better diffusion of oxygen, but they just don't rise very fast. So a little bigger bubble is going to rise fast enough to create this upward flow and bring water into the pond, aerating it and pushing it into the raceway. And we found that the aero tube at a depth of about 1 meter deep will produce a 4 millimeter size bubble roughly. And that's just about the perfect size for this system. So now let's put this in motion. As the bubbles are rising, they're going to draw water in from the bottom, which is going to come from the bottom of the pond. Typically, the bottom pond water is going to be a little more hypoxic and have less dissolved oxygen than the surface waters. So we're going to be more efficient because it's under the saturation level. Remember, saturation means it can't hold any more oxygen. So let's continue this system. Add a few fish. And this is how the system is going to be operating, with a whitewater unit operating perfectly. They're going to be producing dissolved oxygen down to the diffuser grid. And then that rises up through this box-shaped unit into the raceway. Now, typically, the water flow is going to be a little stronger at the surface than at the bottom. But as the water progresses down the length of the raceway, it becomes more uniform in its velocity. Fish are at getting oxygen from the water. They can utilize very minute amounts of oxygen, which being 5 to 10 milligrams per liter. Compare that with the air we breathe, which is 21% oxygen by volume and a density of 1.3 kilograms per cubic meter. Aquamath reveals that's 270 milligrams per liter by weight. That's 30 to 50 times greater than the water. We need to do everything we can to keep the DO at higher levels for the health of the fish. The IPRS and whitewater are a great combination to maintain healthy environment for the fish. Think about your fish the next time you go for a jog or climb up that set of stairs. Here's a fish empathy exercise. To put it all in perspective, obtain 3 drinking straws. Now put one in your mouth and breathe through it. One straw only, without breathing through your nose. Hold your nose if you have to. Now try walking up some stairs. See what I mean? This is what your fish have to live with every night. Now add a second straw and breathe through 2 straws. Much easier, but still not very comfortable. This is what your fish have during the day. Now add the third straw and see how much easier it is to breathe. This is what your fish have with the whitewater unit aeration and the IPRS. The baffle is an essential element of the IPRS layout and integral to the principle of flowing water and mixing. Rather than returning to the raceway head, the baffle forces water to take the long route where it is properly treated, biological oxidation, before returning back to the raceway. The baffle prevents short-circuiting. It can be built as a fence, a wall, or a levee. When several ponds are combined to make a larger volume system, one levee can be left intact and serves as the baffle to force the water to take the long way around the pond. To maintain the principle of flow and mixing, in addition to the whitewater units at the head of each raceway, additional whitewater units are placed near the corners of the pond to maintain the circular riverine flow of water. They should be the same size and design as the raceway whitewater units so that they can be interchanged if necessary. They should be placed in the open pond, not at the levee bank, and the water flow exiting the whitewater unit must be in the same direction as the circular flow pattern for the pond. In this video, you can see the flow of water out of the whitewater unit, and you can see the baffle fence directing the path of the flow. Here's another video of the showing the flow of this pond, and you can see the surface here. You can see the general flow along this pond bank here. This is the pond baffle in the background, and the white water unit is back over in this area pushing water this direction, mixing it, totally mixing the volume, and then it goes through the raceway system and back around in a complete circular pattern. If you follow these bubbles here, you can see moving along, and this is called turbulent flow when we have motion of water in one direction. Removal of waste solids using manual or mechanical methods is a key principle for the success of the IPRS. Reducing this waste load in the pond by removing waste solids as a part of routine management reduces the BOD and allows greater yields than traditional pond methods. Now, fish eliminate about two-thirds of the feed they consume as solid waste. And there's three types of solids in fish waste. Dissolved solids are mostly ammonia excreted through the gills and some liquid wastes as well as some gases. These can't be removed mechanically, but they are removed biologically through nitrification and photosynthesis. Now, suspended solids remain in solution longer. They're silt-like particles, very small, and they can be removed by decomposition and by detrital and filter-feeding fish, such as mullets and silver carps. The settleable solids are the target of our method. They settle quickly and have a thick, mud-like consistency. These are the target for the quiescent zone and can be removed mechanically with a dredge or a pump. 1 kilogram of feed creates about a third of a kilogram of settleable solids. This is another animation I made to help understand the IPRS principle of solid waste removal. Let's put it in motion. Whitewater unit operating at this head end of the raceway. Now we have a full flow and the design flow rate of 6 to 7 centimeters per second is enough to move the fish waste to the quiescent zone area. Once we have the full flow, you can see the waste starts moving and bumping along, goes to the bottom, collects in the quiescent zone, and then it starts accumulating there. Now, once it accumulates to a certain amount, we can run a removal dredge system or a pump type of unit through, and it will sweep up and dredge out these solids. We can do this as often as we need to. If it matters about, if it's several times a day or just once or twice a day, it depends upon the requirements of the individual system. And of course, the bigger the fish, the more they're going to be eating and the more solids they're going to be creating there. The quiescent zone is flat and built on the same grade as the floor of the raceway so that this traveling suction dredge can traverse from side to side and sweep this waste up, transporting it to collection bins. Once removed, the collected waste can be turned into a revenue stream by conversion to methane energy or fertilizer or mulch and sold to other farm users. The solid waste can be removed manually or with automated equipment. As mentioned before, the IPRS is still evolving, and new mechanisms are being invented and installed to more efficiently deal with the solid waste. The goal is to remove as much as possible to keep the pond at a biological peak oxidation. So this is an area that's ripe for innovation, and if anybody has a great idea, give it a try. We could all benefit if you get some improvement. The number three principle of IPRS, confinement, is more or less a catch-all principle that allows many other benefits and advantages to farmers. Other confinement methods are cages and RAS systems. These systems have a captive audience of sorts when it comes to any manipulative management that's required, such as efficient feeding, health management, and harvesting. And the water quality is a more discreet package that can also be managed better. This catch-all principle of confinement allows benefits and advantages to the farmers. High culture densities are usually the norm for these structures. They permit better feeding delivery and feed quality, better aeration delivery and efficiency. Stocking larger fish usually ensures better uniformity at harvest and shorter growing times for a better cash flow. Staggered stocking concept is used to reduce the maximum standing crop biomass. The polyculture is allowed because they separate the species by section, fed species in the raceways, unfed species in the open pond, and this leads to the 80-20 concept where 80% of the harvest and revenues can come from the fed species and 20% of the harvest can come from the unfed service species. Collection and removal of solid waste, as we've mentioned, is possible and facilitated because of the confinement and the concentration of those wastes. Easier access and observation, which is not possible at all in open ponds. Harvesting is simpler and much easier because fish are essentially already caught. Treatments, if required, much less costly than entire ponds, and some compounds are just the cost prohibitive for the entire pond, they could still be utilized in a raceway because the raceways are only 2.5% of the pond area. Protection and biosecurity is facilitated. Predation by birds can be eliminated with inexpensive netting, whereas it would be too expensive for a whole pond. Inventory management, sales and marketing, and cash flow are possible due to this partial harvesting and crowding for harvest. Conservation of water and the environment is facilitated because no drawdown is required for harvesting, and there's no water exchange requirement to keep the water quality in good shape. Raceways are the key confinement structures. So let's begin there. Raceway is simply the term used for a linear or channel type of fish growing container through which aerated water flows to maintain well-fed fish in high densities and in a dynamic and healthy environment. Raceways have been used for over 100 years to grow rainbow trout in the mountains, where stream water is diverted to grow the fish and then returned to the stream. The water is repeatedly aerated as it flows downhill, splashing from one cell to the next. At the end, the water flows through a settling pond and is put back in the stream, although in this case, the returning water now carries dissolved nutrients back to the environment. But again, the major function of the raceway is simply to contain the fish and direct the flowing water. At one time, raceways were promoted in the U.S. as a new idea for growing channel catfish on hilly land where levee-style ponds couldn't be built. I actually built a 10-cell raceway system on our family farm in the 1970s. Our farmland wasn't flat, but the sloping topography was suited to this new idea. So I dug the raceways and situated them in series between an emergency storage reservoir at the top of the hill and a small pond at the bottom. The system was filled with water, which was then pumped from the bottom back to the top to keep the raceways flowing. That system was a little different from the way they're built today, but it still had some of the same principles, features, and benefits of a modern IPRS. But as you can imagine, pumping a large volume of water uphill 24/7 year-round is expensive, and that wasn't profitable. Fast forward about 50 years, and the raceway system has evolved with new designs and efficiencies into a profitable method for growing fish. Parallel raceways are now built in the body of the pond rather than in series on a hillside. But how did we get here? Evolution of the IPRS began in the 1990s when Clemson University researchers divided ponds into sections. One section was built to contain the fish, another to collect the waste, a third to encourage algal growth and biological oxidation. The system was called the Partitioned Aquaculture System, or PAS. The purpose was to maximize fish production per unit of area by engineering for maximum biological nitrification. It was an engineer's dream, but it was a fish farmer's nightmare. However, it did set the stage for the development of IPRS, especially the importance of the flowing water. In this system, it was powered by slow-turning paddle wheels. In 2005, Auburn University began to improve on these designs and focused on developing commercial-scale raceways. The first raceways were built with concrete and blocks. The water flow was powered by close-tolerance, low-RPM turning paddle wheels, which could move 10 complete volume exchanges per hour. Variable-speed drive motors determined the flow rate of water because each paddle moves a certain amount of water into the raceway. Dissolved oxygen supplied to fish in the raceways comes from that already entrained in the pond. But during late summer, when temperature and standing crop is high and dissolved oxygen is low, supplemental aeration is required to maintain adequate levels for the fish. The need for supplemental diffuser aeration combined with the high maintenance of the mechanical paddle wheels led to the development of the whitewater units that serve both purposes. In 2013, the U.S. soybean industry extended the IPRS technology to China with a 3-cell raceway demonstration. This proved the value of the system, especially feeding high-quality soy-based floating feeds. The demonstration was a huge success. Since then, the number of raceway cells has skyrocketed to an estimated 6,000 raceways in 2019, and China is the number one customer for U.S. soybean products. The IPRS technology is being adopted in many countries around the world. Farmers using this technology are buying feeds with high-quality U.S.-grown soybeans, and they're growing dozens of fish and aquatic species. Just about any fish that can take a pelleted feed can be grown successfully in these raceways and the IPRS system. This is a list of fish species that are suitable for the IPRS. Are you growing a species that is not on this list? Well, go ahead and build the IPRS on your farm and you could make history and you can make this list. Building the raceways. Three designs or types of raceways are currently employed. Fixed floor durable concrete raceways, low cost pond liner, and floating raceway designs. Ponds must be drained and dried and leveled before building fixed floor durable or low cost designs. Robust designs are made of brick or block and concrete. Foundations and vertical pillars are poured, followed by laying block walls for the raceway sides. They have a long expected useful life, maybe 20 or 30 years plus. The low-cost designs are typically made of pond liner plastic draped across fence post type of constructions. They have a limited life of approximately 5 to 7 years, and they may also have other drawbacks. It will be up to the individual user to step carefully and learn the system. Floating raceways are typically built off-site of any durable material. Each farmer may have access to various building materials for construction. Floating raceways may be most useful if the operator is renting the pond or if the site is unable to be drained. With sufficient demand for IPRS constructions, there may be significant opportunity for a contractor to start a new industry building and installing raceways of any specific design. This could ensure a standard size and uniformity for compatibility among systems and would include other equipment, such as whether whitewater units could be portable between farms and among raceways. A staggered production strategy is employed to optimize managing pond waste load across a production year and to manage risk. Two or three sizes of fish are cultured at the same time. Similar to mixed batch culture, we recognize the value of a continual flow of cohorts of fish passing through the pond. Using this approach, different sizes are present, but they are segregated into different raceways and harvested at different times. The idea is that the maximum standing crop at any point in time never exceeds the maximum biomass that the pond's biological dynamics can handle. Partial harvesting can be accomplished easily to fill small market orders for less than the entire crop in a raceway cell. Another feature of staggered stocking is that we stock larger sized fish than are typically started in ponds, and this technique brings a more uniformly sized crop to market, and the grow out time to market is significantly shorter. That being the case, oftentimes two crops can be grown each year instead of a single crop. Staggered stocking at different months can be employed easily. This helps maintain the lower biomass mentioned before, than much lower than traditional single stocking. That can be put on a spreadsheet. Tilapia are an excellent candidate species for IPRS because they can withstand high densities, they have a fast growth to market cycle, and they can eat a variety of foodstuffs and grow well on soy protein. So some of the harvest density trials that have been done with tilapia in IPRS ponds, in Egypt they've determined up to 65 kilograms per cubic meter of raceway volume. In Latin America, that number up to 88 and even 100 kilograms per cubic meter is possible. The IPRS system with three raceways of 54 cubic meters each, that's 162 cubic meters of raceway volume. These are designed for a one fed-in pond that's about 2.5 meters deep. That would be 9,000 cubic meters of pond volume. So the calculated yield for a single crop of tilapia is about 10,000 to 16,000 kilograms. And then we could add the production of unfed mullet on top of that. Using a staggered stocking of large fingerlings and two crops per year, we can push that production potential to a calculated 21,000 to 32,000 kilograms of tilapia plus mullet. Now these actual yields, of course, will vary among farms, ponds, individual cells. One of our management calculations is to decide how many fish to stock in the raceway. There's three things that we need to know to calculate these stocking rates. We want to know our target final biomass, and we want to know our target average fish weight, and we want to know the total raceway growing volume. So in this case, depends upon our target harvest size, whether do we want 350 grams, 400 grams, 500 grams. And do we want to harvest at a density of 40 kilograms per cubic meter or 65 kilograms per cubic meter? And our raceway volume. What is our raceway volume? Is it 54 cubic meters, which is becoming the standard? Or is it a larger, much larger raceway of 220 cubic meters? So the stocking rate then is equal to the target density times the raceway volume, and then divide that by the target harvest size in kilograms. So as an example, 40 is kilograms per cubic meter. That's our target density, times 54, which is our raceway volume. Divide that by 0.35, which is 350 grams, and that tells us that we need to stock 6,200 fish. Now, if we're going to target a density of 65 kilograms per cubic meter in the same raceway, and we're going to target a half of a kilogram fish, 500 grams, then that calculation in AquaMath tells us 7,000 fish. We're stocking advanced fingerlings, and we can produce two crops per year. Again, the caveat is the actual yields will vary among farms, ponds, and individual cells. Let's do this calculation again with an AquaMath, calculating the stocking rate with a target of 350 grams harvest size. So we need the final biomass, the average weight, and the raceway growing volume. An example for Egypt, where tilapia in a 54 cubic meter IPRS raceway cell and target our maximum biomass of 65. Our harvest size is 350 grams, raceway growing volume 54 cubic meters. So our stocking rate, target biomass times raceway volume divided by the target harvest size. So the AquaMath shows that we need to stock 10,028 fish per raceway cell. Now you're not going to be able to get exact like that, but you're going to use a weight and volume method for stocking the fish. So the optional adjustment then for a predicted survival rate, let's just say it's 95%. We can back this out by dividing by 95%, and we get a total of 10,555 fish per raceway cell. Let's do the same calculation we just did for a 350 gram target size, and let's target 500 grams. So all the math is the same except the 500 grams. So we're going to come down to where our stocking rate is equal to 65, which is our density, desired density, 54 is our raceway volume, and divide that by 500 grams or 0.5 kilograms to give us 7,000 fish per raceway cell. Dividing out by 95% to get a to factor in the predicted survival rate will give us 7,400 fish per cell. So stocking the fish, it's very important to handle them carefully and gently. You may even want to give a prophylactic dip treatment of some kind of a therapeutic to make sure that they're going to be healthy and active when they're put into the raceway for stocking. So here's an example of some fish that have been counted by weight, and then they're moving them from the hauling truck into this person who's putting them into the raceway to start their growth cycle. I think this was Colombia. One of the principles of the raceway method for growing fish is that we're going to start with typically a larger fish, and these are called stockers. So our target biomass is lower for a stocker development than it is for grow out. Large fingerlings are going to reach market size faster, and they're going to be more uniform in size, and we'll be able to produce more than one crop per year. So to produce 90 gram fingerlings in a standard 54 cubic meter raceway at 30 kilograms per cubic meter density, according to the AquaMath, we're going to stock 18,000 fish. Now to produce 50 gram fingerlings in a standard raceway, with everything else the same, we're going to look at 32,000 fish. But we always want to stock healthy fish that have been graded for size and uniformity, and we want to make sure that they're transported in a very aerated, clean water and handled very carefully so that they're not injured. So poor uniformity in stocked fish can result if we don't take very, very good care of them. This graph is comparing the growth of 90 gram fish and 30 gram fish to 350 gram harvest size. So over a 110 day period, the 30 gram fish grew to the 350 gram size. However, the 90 gram fish reached 350 grams after 60 days. They continued on. So if theoretically, then if we start with 90 gram fish as a first stocker, we could get two crops of fish to 350 grams in a growing season. Nutritious and high-quality soy-based feeds are used in IPRS because all of the feed is consumed and none is wasted. Feeding fish in confinement allows the operator to observe the activity and determine whether the fish are being overfed or underfed, and the manager can then take appropriate action. Floating feed is considered a management tool. It helps assess fish health and condition. A lack of feeding vigor often indicates more serious problems, such as poor water quality or disease infections. Confinement also eliminates the windblown feed that ends up wasted in the pond bank vegetation. Divide daily rations into multiple applications of feeding to enhance stock uniformity as well as feed efficiency. This isn't practical in large farm settings. To achieve the optimal feed efficiency, divide the daily ration into multiple feedings instead of just once a day. The 90% satiation method is developed by USEC. This dedicates one day every week or 10 days for feeding to satiation all the fish will eat over a 20 to 30 minute period of time. Record this amount of feed. It's called the satiation ration. Multiply it by 90%, and this is called the 90% ration. Then feed that amount for the next 6 or 10 days and divide it over multiple daily feedings. Repeat the satiation feeding and recalculate the new 90% ration every week or 10 days. The use of automated and demand feeders can facilitate this regimen rather than using hand labor for each feeding. All these factors, along with the high survival in IPRS, combine to achieve maximum FCR possible. The old methods of making feed were called lowest cost feed formulations, but they always had inferior ingredients and often resulted in terrible FCRs. The new feed making goal is to have the highest quality feeds with the lowest cost per unit of gain, and this includes U.S. soybean products. Watching the fish feeding can be therapeutic, or if nothing else, it's satisfying to see your healthy fish in action. The bottom line, it really works. In this floating raceway, 3,500 kilograms of hybrid channel catfish fed 45 kilograms of feed. It took them less than 2 minutes to clean up every bit. And you'll watch the distribution of the feed around in various areas rather than all up at the upper end, because some of the fish are just not as aggressive and they will be in the laying back in the back of the school, so to speak, so they would need to be distributed some feed there as well. But you can notice that feed doesn't even make it halfway down the raceway. Notice how actively the fish are feeding, and this is the first part of the feeding. You'll notice that as they receive the food, as time goes by, the feeding activity starts to slow down somewhat. And by the end of the feeding, it has slowed down considerably, but the fish are still hungry and they could still eat more. So if this was to be a 90% satiation example, we would continue to feed as long as the fish take the food and before it reaches the end of the raceway. Now there is a skirt in case there is food that gets to the end, it won't float out. But we would record the amount of food that they want for this period of time, multiply it by 90%, and that becomes the feeding for the next week to 10 days.
How much feed was that, Avery?
100 pounds.
100 pounds of feed.
Okay, so let's have a little fun with aquamath, and let's talk about the 90% satiation method for feeding. But first, let's say we're going to stock 10,000 tilapia fingerlings into a Raceway cell. Now, the average weight, 30 grams. Calculate the daily ration if we feed 5% the body weight daily. Well, the daily ration is going to be 10,000 fish times 0.03 kilogram, which is 30 gram fish, times 0.05, or 5% of the body weight daily. That's 300 kilograms times 0.05, or 15 kilograms of feed per day for these 10,000 fingerlings. Now, if we estimate an FCR of 1.2 for 20 days, recalculate the daily ration. So, aquamath, let's look at this. We have 20 days. We have the 15 kilograms is what we're feeding every day for 20 days. And this is a conversion ratio here. 1 kilogram to 1.2 kilograms is our feed conversion ratio. So add the 300 kilograms from the initial time period and multiply that by 0.05, and we get 27.5 kilograms. That is our estimated daily ration. Now, let's talk about the 90% satiation. Now, what we need to do there is feed ad libitum. That means as much as they want to take. Typically, you can do that in about 20 minutes. So if we feed ad libitum for one day and we find that the fish ate 37 kilograms. So our 90% satiation means that we take 90% of that 37 kilogram and divide that into several multiple feedings, but feed that amount over the next week or 10 days. So let's calculate the new feeding rate using the 90% satiation schedule. Okay, so the new feeding rate, we knew it was 37 kilograms, and we're multiplying that times 0.9, or 90%, and that gives us 33 kilograms per day. So we're actually underfeeding these fish. So this is the value of the satiation method that can help you reach a faster growth and a better growth and a better FCR conversion ratio. One more thing, let's calculate the biomass growth for the next 20 days, and let's base that on an FCR of 1.3. How do we do that? All right, so we have 20 days. We have 33.3 kilograms per day of food. Here is our feed conversion ratio. And so our biomass growth is going to be 512 kilograms. So we add that to the 300 that we had before. These are the feeding diets based on the USEC tilapia diets. There are three levels of protein, high, medium, and low at 35, 32, and 30. Now, typically, the smaller fish are fed the higher protein, and then as they grow, then they will be fed the lower protein, as you can see. From 30 grams to 100 grams, they would receive the 35%, 35.6, and then from 100 to 250, the 32.6, and then from 250 to 500 would be fed the 30 protein 6 fat. The growth rate estimated in grams per day in Mexico was from some trials done there. But the other thing about this would be to note that, and to improve pond water quality, if the pond water quality is going down, we want to reduce the amount of feed daily. We don't want to reduce the protein level. We want to reduce the amount of feed daily, or just stop feeding for a day and then feed the next day, feed every other day until the water quality starts improving. Don't just reduce the amount of feed daily even, because then the hogs are going to get it all and the shy fish are not going to get any. So we wait until every other day. Now, one of our management checkups is to sample the fish and check them for their growth rates and for the health. Maybe do a routine biopsy of the gills, the skin, and the fins to determine if they have a parasite load or any kind of infection. So, but we want to sample in a way that does not overly excite the fish. dip netting, lift netting, a baited hook and line, sabiki rig or something like that, which is a small, what they call bait chaser. Cast netting is not recommended because it excites the fish too much and they can damage themselves trying to get away. Here's an example of a cast netting that was one of the most beautiful cast nettings I've ever seen. Unfortunately, it had a not so good result. So as you can see, this is a large raceway, and that was a very large cast net. And if you look to the right-hand side, you can see it really disturbed the fish in the adjacent raceway also. But what happened is that these fish started running into the walls and jumping, and they damaged their heads and had a lot of trauma and started showing up dead after the next week. So there were a lot of mortalities that occurred from this one incident here. So here's an example of using a proper sampling method. It doesn't have to be traumatic. Just scoop a net down in and dip some of the fish up while they're feeding, and you can get enough to do a sample, and you'll know what the average size is, and you can also take some fish for a health evaluation and assay. Biosecurity is a critical concept in modern fish farming. It is a requirement for best management practices and a good idea on top of that. You can protect the entire crop more easily from human poachers and avian predators. Covering an entire pond with bird netting is very expensive, but the raceways take up only a small area in the pond, so they can be covered more easily and inexpensively. Another concern is the confining gates. But the gates are what keep the fish in the raceways. However, they will get fouled with a layer of growth that can clog or reduce the flow through rate. Brush them regularly with a stiff bristle shop broom on both sides to maintain the desired water flow rate, both upstream and downstream gates and the quiescent zone gate. Don't use a nylon or other material as it is not durable and will not stand up to regular cleaning, but PVC-coated metal or stainless steel mesh is the best type of material. Also, the netting, it can become ripped and fish will escape. Therapeutic treatments are another aspect of biosecurity and, if required, can be accomplished easily and very inexpensively, especially compared with treatment of the entire pond. Also, there are some therapeutic agents that are too expensive for pond use, but they are affordable and easily used in raceway fish health maintenance. The protocol is to drop a tarp or some kind of covering over the confinement gate at the tail end of the raceway. Leave the whitewater unit operating, and the flow becomes a recirculating stream within the raceway, down the top and back up the bottom. Supplementary aeration may also be required to maintain adequate oxygen levels for the fish during treatment. Add the compounds for the required amount of time, and then remove the gate covering and resume normal IPRS operations. You may want to take some time later and study this chart here, but the main point about this is just showing the differences in the cost and amount of product used for therapeutic treatments between a pond and a raceway. For example, potassium permanganate costs $250 for a pond to treat one time at 5 milligrams per liter. In a raceway, to treat at 20 milligrams per liter, only $22, so about one-tenth the cost. For formalin, as you can see, it's really not useful for ponds just because of its expense. One treatment at 15 milligrams per liter is over $1,000 U.S., whereas in a raceway, at even a higher rate of 25 milligrams per liter, only $38. So that's almost 30 times different. That'd be the takeaway from this. One of the IPRS principles is polyculture, and this includes the fed and the unfed species or service species. Now we can apply the 80-20 rule here, and that is that 80% of the total production could come from the fed species, with another 20% coming from unfed species. These would be service species that are stocked in the pond, not the raceway, and they improve the water quality. Filter feeders and detrital feeders, they consume phytoplankton, suspended solids, detritus. Typical species used are silver carp, bighead carp, mullet, and even tilapia, but you do not feed them. That's an IPRS principle. Do not feed any species outside the raceways. So if you're using tilapia, for example, in the pond as a service species, then all they're going to do is be taking the algae and other biomass natural food that they can find. Because fish are already in confinement, harvesting from raceways is simple. They are already caught. There's no need for seining equipment or large crews of people. When sampling indicates fish have reached the target size, schedule your harvest with the processor or specialty market. Use a crowding device that stretches across the entire raceway width and move it slowly from one end of the raceway to the other. If you're high grading the fish for a specialty market, use a crowder device with greater bars spaced correctly to allow small fish to swim through and back into the lower end of the raceway. Carefully lift fish out of the crowded area with dip nets or harvest lift nets or special vacuum fish pumps. Typically, fish are harvested and transported to the buyer in a live haul truck with tanks of oxygenated water. Handle fish gently because if they're handled roughly and stressed, they can lose weight and will be reduced quality for the market. This advice especially applies if you're harvesting fingerlings or advanced stockers because they need to be in top shape before stocking into the raceways for grow out. The IPRS allows live harvest of quality fresh fish to supply a processing facility or a premium niche marketer of live fish. Now, when it comes to harvesting tilapia from the IPRS, remember, the fish are already caught. So we just need to crowd them into one end and just basically dip them out with a net. Now, if you're having problems with the depth of the water, then you want to use your tallest guys to pull that net through. The collection and removal of solid waste in open pond aquaculture is only used after ponds are drained and dried out, and then only with large earth-moving equipment. The design flow velocity of 6 or 7 centimeters per second is required to move a solid waste to the quiescent zone. The zone is located at the tail end of the raceways, and note that the confinement gate slots are double so that you never have to leave one open. You can always leave one closed while exchanging the other one. So when handling the solid wastes, it's important to keep in mind, do not return this to the environment, because that's the whole purpose of taking it out of the pond, so we can reduce the pollution to the environment and help protect the environment. Instead, use this as a benefit. You can create a stream of revenue, which can be sent to a digestion chamber of some kind to produce methane for energy. It can be applied directly to crops or vegetables for a fertilizer, maybe even for sale. It could be mulched with an organic crop waste and produce a compost for sale. And it can be combined with other type of residues for culturing worms that could then be food or feed or added to feed. Avoid this. This is an example of kind of what not to do, but this is the waste from a quiescent zone, but it is going into a ditch and then returning back to the source. So it's not a good use of it. Well, what I think would be better to do is impound an area here and then let the waste settle. Then it could be dried and repackaged and sold. Why not create a stream of revenue from your waste and turn it into some profit? Here is the collected waste, and it's very thick, very mud-like, so this is something that can be definitely used as an income stream. It's highly nutritious for plants, a lot of nitrates in there, a lot of fertilizer compounds. So use it, sell it. The supplementary air systems are intended to add in on dissolved oxygen when the biomass is extremely large and when the temperatures are warm, lowering the saturation of dissolved oxygen. And the times to use this is when your biomass becomes 60% of your target for the pond system. The supplementary air system should be installed in the first part of the raceway, not beyond halfway. Doing so, if it goes past halfway, it's going to resuspend the solids that may then escape the quiescent zone. So we want to stop it halfway so the solids can settle out and then bump along into the quiescent zone where they can be removed from the system. So for the supplementary air system, we drop an air line every meter and a half to another diffuser tubing. And this is the tubing then is installed with some kind of heavy weight inside, which also holds it linear and keeps it down on the bottom. They can be located at the base of the sidewalls, not out in the middle, because that's going to inhibit water flow. So we're going to put them along the sides and not come up off the bottom. That would reduce the velocity of water and interfere with the traverse of these solids. Have a backup plan. Plan A, a generator that can handle all of the electrical needs for the farm. The standby generator, it is a critical piece of equipment. It is a type of insurance policy bought for the farm. It's critical to operate this machine under a load weekly. Operate even something like a fire drill to ensure that everybody knows how to respond to an emergency or interruption in power. The people who are responsible for being sure the generator starts and runs smoothly, they need to be thoroughly trained to troubleshoot operation and maintenance of the generator. Generators that operate on LP, CNG, or natural gas are more reliable than gasoline-powered generators. Diesel is also good and reliable, but they're typically more expensive to purchase. So the purposes and the needs for this is there's a very short reaction time for power outages. These generators require self-starting and an outage alarm. Generators must be tested weekly and operated under a load. Think about a fire drill. So if plan A doesn't work for some reason, you need to have a backup plan, plan B. Now this would mean other mechanisms that could bring oxygen to the fish. Because of the extremely high densities of fish in the raceways, we have to consider and make plans for emergencies, including other than power outages, things that stop the whitewater units from aerating and flowing the water. So solar power can be stored in DC batteries for use when the AC power is off. Electric propeller trolling motors produce a surprisingly strong current for the amount of power they draw, and it's available even when the main power source is turned off. But if this is something that you're looking at, it would be very important to correctly match the size of the electrical needs with the DC supply and make sure that there's enough reserve to last for a while, especially overnight. Now, oxygenation is the process of causing oxygen to be dissolved directly from pure oxygen sources such as liquid or bottled oxygen. It's usually diffused from microbubbler ceramic devices to enhance the solution. And a valve that's normally off can be activated by a power outage to turn the oxygen on automatically during an outage. So now we have backup plan A and B. Here's a backup plan C. That is, if nothing else works, we want to save the fish and release them back to the open pond and let them find oxygen. You can trap them back later because they will come to feed. They're very much like any animal. They're creatures of habit, and they know where the feed is, and they know how to get to it. So they will swim back in. You can put a funnel-shaped device on the quiescent zone and another one on the tail end confinement gate, and then the fish will swim through those cones and stay in the raceway. Alarm systems are also a requirement. So when you have an electric outage, you need to know that even if you're not on site. Even though your generator supposedly starts automatically, you still need to come to the site and verify that everything's working properly. Also, an air pressure sensor in the air supply lines is an important alarm to have, because even if you have electricity and the pumps are running, the air blowers are running, if you have a break in the air line, then the pressure will go down, and the airlift's whitewater units will stop operating. You will not get an alarm that the electricity is off, but you need to have the air pressure alarm as well. There also could be a dissolved oxygen sensor, and this would be sort of like a fail-safe or a backup, just in case something's going on other than the two things mentioned. Maybe something clogged up one of the entrances, entrance gates to the raceway with grass or weeds or something like that. Then you'll get a dissolved oxygen alert. So there is possible to do that with these controls now. So some of the various things to consider in your management system. First of all, you want to size the system properly, including the number of raceways, the size of raceways for the size of the pond. And remember that incorporating several ponds into one system that's much larger in volume will be a much more effective system. You can put more raceways in there, but there's also more water volume to condition the water before it goes back through the raceways again. Other management jobs are to calculate the stocking rates, feeding rates, sampling for size and growth, also for health, and harvesting, and then maintenance tasks and record keeping. So let's look at some of these. Here's an example of some of the routine maintenance and cleaning tasks that you'll be needing to do. You're going to remove the solid waste. If you automate that, then no worries, just check the pumps and the dredges to make sure they're operating properly. But if you're going to be doing it by hand, you want to do that 2 or 3 times daily, or you'll notice the buildup, and it's going to be a more of a buildup as the fish get larger and start eating more. So another weekly task is the whitewater units and diffusers, blowers, and airlines. Double check the filters for the blowers, the airlines for leaks, diffusers, and maybe clean the diffuser tubings. Other weekly task, brush the confinement gates, both sides, front and back, at the tail end and the head end, as well as the screens on the quiescent zone. And you want to back up the generator and do a fire drill, test the auto start, and run it at full load. An important maintenance task is to maintain the water flow and velocity in the raceways. Now, the velocity, it can be determined using a pipe that's been filled with some dirt or sand or something heavy, but not completely full. Just put enough in it so that when you put it in the water, it floats vertically in the water. You might, and then put a cap on top. You want the bottom of the pipe to reach down to almost to the bottom of the raceway, and the top of the pipe to be above the water surface so that you can observe its progress. Then you put this velocity indicator, which is just, as we said, a piece of PVC pipe with some dirt in it. Put that in the head of the raceway near the whitewater unit and time it as it traverses from one end to the other. Do that several times. You may even build 3 or 4 of those and put them all in at the same time, and then you can get a good average of the length of time it takes. So the desired velocity is 6 to 7 centimeters per second. That'll create a turnover of about 10 exchanges per hour, or approximately 1 volume exchange every 6 minutes. So if you put these vertical pipe indicators in, they should take 6 minutes or less to reach from the head end to the tail end of the raceway. Now the figure at the left is the same idea. It's a float with a line dropped down to a drogue, which is just a device that offers resistance to the water flow. So it will flow along, the drogue will flow at a slower rate, and the float at the surface will be pushed along at a faster rate, so you'll get an average. But other things to consider in this is that maybe the diffuser grid has gotten clogged, So you should pull the grid out and clean the diffuser tubing, clean the blower filter that the air comes into the blower through. Also, make sure there's no other blockages or holes or broken tubing of the diffuser grids. So record keeping is also important. That way you can't always remember what things are going on. And so if you keep records, you'll be able to go back and you have something to compare. And so daily water quality test measurements are a very important thing to record, because then you can go back through time and notice if there's some trends. Maybe it's ammonia or dissolved oxygen that's increasing or decreasing, pH. And so you'll have something to go by there. You want to record your once a week satiation calculations and your ration, your 90% ration, so that you can keep track of that feeding. You can even calculate your growth and compare it with your harvest at the end of the season. Daily feeding rations, mortality is noted and removed. Then if you notice that there's more and more mortalities, then you know something's up and you want to start looking into that and take action. Any treatments that you've done, including other management actions. And then if you see any strange fish behavior or any changes, including the feeding vigor, things like that you want to make a note of. And if you have several people working, if one comes in, they can look at the notes of the other, and then sort of they know where to go from there. This is a graph of the daily water conditions on a farm where I worked for four different ponds over a several month period of time. It shows the interactions between water quality parameters, dissolved oxygen, daily fluctuations, pH, CO2. It also shows the weather conditions and when it was cloudy and what effect that had on the water quality parameters. It shows the amount of feed that we fed every day and the effect that that had over time on the water quality. And it shows the treatments when we treated with potassium permanganate, the effect that that had. And what this does is it helps you understand how your management actions affect the water quality of the fish that you're taking care of. And it's just important to keep records. And this is a good plug for record keeping so that you can better manage your farm. Now, as a parenthetical, we did not have the in-pond raceway system back then. And so these dissolved oxygen figures are much lower than they could have been for the fish if we had of the in-pond raceway system. Well, let's do a review of the advantages and disadvantages. Let's do a summary of the in-pond raceway system. And we have some interviews with current users of the method. And let's just see what they have to say about the IPRS. It is an intensive aquaculture system that you can employ in your existing ponds to increase production by two or threefold. It's not a new technology in itself, but it's a well-designed combination of existing technologies that are well-known. It's disruptive in a sense because it's leading a new revolution in pond-based aquaculture. It is a principle-driven concept. The number one principle is flowing water, mixing, and management of dissolved oxygen, sort of a three-in-one that go hand in hand. Other basic principles are confinement and the removal of waste. It has been developed over many years of research and on-farm improvements and is still evolving with better designs and continuous improvements. Its purpose is to modernize fish farming in ponds and maximize your production safely and efficiently. The bottom line is that when used as designed, it really works. You will have success with the IPRS if you learn and follow the principles. This is a long list of advantages and benefits for the in-pond raceway system over traditional aquaculture pond methods. Increased production 200 or 300%, improved FCR, and reduced cost of feeding, even down to 1.2 to 1 as possible. Reduce the risk because you have healthier fish and better water quality. We have much better ability to observe the fish and assess their health and appetites because we're right there where they are, not out in the middle of the pond. Improved survival, we're getting better than 90%. You can eliminate predation by people, birds, and other fish. You can reduce energy costs per pound or per kilogram produced. And we have better control over inventory. Staggered stocking and partial harvesting allows better cash flow and multiple harvests, multiple crops per year. Polyculture in the open pond area gives us additional fish crop and additional revenues. Easier to manage the fish health and less costly to treat if we have diseases and require treatments. Much easier to sample and grade and harvest the fish. Conserving water is one of the key benefits. Drawdown is not required to harvest, and there's no water exchange required. We can capture waste nutrients for use as fertilizer, mulch, or methane production. And we can reduce energy, feed, and labor costs per unit of weight gain and increase our overall profits. Now, there is a small list of disadvantages for the in-pond raceway system. You do have to build one, and it's going to cost. So that's why we went through the various designs. The difference in, we didn't cover the cost of those, but we do know that the robust concrete construction is the most costly of those designs, but it does last a long time. It's very durable. The low-cost pond liner is going to be a lower-cost way to get into this system. The floating raceways are very costly per unit of growing volume. So that would only be feasible for typically smaller scale operations. Now, there is no cookie cutter ready to go designs or plans. We do have designs and plans, engineered drawings for the raceways, for the concrete raceways, and for the airlift. So those are available, but every design seems to be different. There's learning curves for different management skills for the operators that are different and compared to the traditional pond culture. There's new tasks to incorporate into the daily and weekly protocols. And the densities are higher in these systems, which means it's much more critical to keep a close eye and a close watch on them to discover and assess the fish health and prevent the spread of diseases. There's a short reaction time to emergencies and power outages, meaning that dissolved oxygen can drop quickly if the water supply is shut off or aeration supply is shut down. So constant electricity supply is essential, and a reliable backup generator is a requirement.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. عايز اتكلم النهاردة عن تجربتي الخاصة في الصغراء المكثف عن طريق نظام IPRS. بداية اشكر الدكتور جمال النجار والدكتور محمد فتحي عثمان واليوسك على التكنيكال سبورت والفاينانشال سبورت اللي قدموه لنا. موضوع الاستزراع بنظام IPRS انا شايف ان هو موضوع واعد جدا واعد جدا لزيادة الانتاج للمتر المكعب عن طريق معالجة المية عن طريق الوايت ووتر يونت او سحب الويست برودكتس من الكويسنت زون في الوحدة اللي عندي عبارة عن 6 خلايا كل خلية مساحتها 55 متر مكعب نستهدف منها في الموسم ان شاء الله ان احنا نوصل من 5-6 طن للخلية عن طريق عمل دورة او دورتين. اهم حاجة في النظام IPRS هو المتابعة الدقيقة ومتابعة التهوية والقياسات. قياسات الامونيا والاكسجين والـ pH
My name is Harrison Charo Karisa. I'm the country director for Egypt and Nigeria at WorldFish. The in-pond raceway system in short IPRS, that we have adapted for Egypt, especially to work to test it on tilapia, has shown some very, very good prospects for improving the productivity of our ponds in Egypt. Egypt, as the leading country in Africa, will again show the way in terms of ensuring that we are able to get as much more tilapia as required by the consumers. We have right now working with the US Soy Export Council to test the same system, IPRS system, with African catfish, Clarus garipinus. They are very, very good prospects. Working with the Gawaad, that has the General Authority for Fisheries Resource Development, that has accepted to use their facilities as a place where we can initiate the catfish production. We think this is going to be a game changer in terms of enabling the Egyptian farmer to test a new species that has not been doing very well. One of the things.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أنا عاطف عبد الجواد من محافظة البحيرة. سمحت عن استزراع السمك الجديد بتاع الـ IPRS. يعني أنا من هواة التجربة دايما، أي تجربة بنحاول إن أنا نجرب مرة واثنين، وهو العلم اتبنى على إن الإنسان يجرب يعني. فهيئة السوية الأمريكية سمحت إن هي بتدعم المزارعين من ناحية النظام بتاع الـ IPRS. فتواصلت مع الدكتور جمال النجار وبدأنا التجربة بالفعل، والدكتور جمال النجار أشرف معانا على التجربة، وبنينا الحمد لله الموسم اللي فات في نهاية الموسم تقريبا كنا 28/8 بداية 9 كنا بنينا 3 خلايا. الثلاث خلايا دول زرعناهم الموسم اللي فات، ولكن مر علينا أخطاء في التجربة بتاعة الموسم اللي فات، والحمد لله انتجنا منها انتاجية مش بطالة. فبدأنا السنة دي ان احنا نتلاشى كل الاخطاء بتاعة الموسم اللي فات وعدلناها، وكان في اخطاء في المباني نفسها عدلناها، وبدأنا نزرع كثافات احسن، وزرعنا الحوض اللي بره بكثافات ممتازة برضو. كنا زارعين السنة اللي فاتت الحوض الخارجي كثافات بسيطة، وكان في سمك خرج مننا الموسم اللي فات في الحوض الخارجي. تلاشينا كل الاخطاء وزرعنا السنة دي الحمد لله كثافة الخلية الأولى زرعناها 12,000، الخلية الثانية زرعناها 15,000، الخلية الثالثة زرعناها 17,000. والحمد لله الخلية الأولى استوت من حوالي 10 أيام واصطدناها، أنتجت حوالي 3.5 طن. فاضل الخلية الثانية والخلية الثالثة، هم حاليا دلوقتي برضو مستويين، إنما اللي معطلنا إن السوق وحش جدا، والحمد لله محضرين للدورة الثانية في الموسم الثاني اللي هو الحالي. سمك حاليا دلوقتي 40 جرام، عاملين عليه عينه من حوالي اسبوع او 5 ايام تقريبا 40 جرام. هنطلع الخليتين اللي فاضلين وهنزرع السمك ال 40 جرام، وان شاء الله باذن الله نهايه الموسم هيكون الانتاج ان شاء الله كويس جدا. وعلى فكره السمك اللي بره احنا ما بنعلفهوش، السمك اللي بره بنحط له نسبه رجيعه في بدايه الموسم في العلفه الثانيه. تقريبا بدأنا ب 3 كيلو رجيعة في اليوم، حاليا وصلنا 5 كيلو رجيعة، والسمك اللي بره بيكبر بمستوى مش بطال، مستوى كويس جدا. فبالتالي لو جمعنا في نهاية الدورة الثلاث خلايا، انتاجية الثلاث خلايا زائد الحوض الخارجي اللي هو سمك حاليا دلوقتي تقريبا ما بيتعلفش خالص غير حبة الرجيعة، هنلاقي معامل تحويل مبهر إن شاء الله. ونتمنى لكل أي حد عايز يجرب التجربة دي بالتوفيق والنجاح إن شاء الله.
This is a presentation for the United States Soybean Export Council by Skip Kemp, a visual guide to understanding and using the IPRS in-pond raceway system. Build the in-pond raceway system and your happy fish will thank you. Remember, we have much more available oxygen than they do, and the in-pond raceway system and whitewater unit is an ideal way to supply healthy oxygen and nutritious complete food with soybean products. Thank you for watching, and we hope you've learned something, and we hope that this film has increased your interest in the IPRS. The United States Soybean Export Council has experts on hand to help answer your technical questions and help you guide you toward building your system in your farm. For more information, contact the U.S. Soybean Export Council and visit their website. In addition, you can visit my YouTube channel at PSKemp2 and find more information on aquaculture and the in-pond raceway system.